Mr. Raginski, this film, could it have been shown on Central Television in Moscow?
Такой фильм могли бы показывать по телевидению в России?
Ну, во всяком случае, это не запрещено. Его бы никто не запретил, но просто, может быть, его бы не взяли, потому что посчитали бы, что он недостаточно желтый. У нас
про 30-е годы и про всю эту драму любят показывать желтые фильмы. Желтые, как оптимисты.
Yellow Press.
Да, сенсационные. Ну да, там где значит.
So they could have shown it, nobody would have been, nobody would have said no, but I don't think it would be, it would have a big public because they liked the sensational press, they liked the sensational press more.
Это, в общем, честно говоря, это очень скромный и правдивый фильм, правдивый, действительно, в нем нет ничего нецензурного для советского российского кино.
So there is this is actually a very humble, a very righteous film, but there is no censorship, there is no forbidden subject.
Это слишком черная такая, знаете, как бы сказать, слишком черно показано наше прошлое, и это не очень.
But it's too much of a dark story. Too much of a dark story about our past, as the authorities might consider.
И вряд ли его покажут.
So I don't think they would have shown it.
Arnaud, in the 7 years that you have worked in Moscow, did you see a lot of these kinds of films?
No, I haven't, of course. But I have traveled extensively, and I have met quite a few people who could be compared to the people in this movie, and who would tell you life stories which, to an ordinary Dutchman, are simply unimaginable. But also what is interesting, I found also quite some patriots, as they call it in Russia, of the place where these people were thrown by fate or history. For instance, in Ta or Varkuta, where there were huge camps and where some people were brought from very far regions, they actually stayed, of course, after they were released. Some married. I met one Latvian woman who was sent there, who worked there, who then was released and who married some hero of the Soviet army and forever stayed in this very Varkuta. So the history of this gulag is for us, I think, difficult to understand.
It's what the Russians call Dalshe ne sashlut. It gives a feeling of freedom.
Can you elaborate?
Выяснить, что это именно означает? Дальше не сошлют.
Ну, это значит, я свободен, ничего со мной уже особенно не сделают.
It means I'm free. Мне
уже так плохо, что хуже уже не будет.
I'm free. There is no place that can send me after this, and it's been so bad that it can't get any worse.
Но люди остаются в тех местах, где они сидели, по очень многим причинам.
People stay in those places where they have been imprisoned for so long for many reasons. Most of them just don't have a place to go home to.
You, Arnaud, you were in Moscow for the Volkskrant for 7 years. Your final story, I remember, was on Salavki. Salavki is, as far as I know, the first labor camp organized under Lenin still. In the 1920s, why did you go there, and what did you find?
Well, I went there. We went there, I should say, with my wife, because obviously it's a place full of symbolism for Russia, and it was, I thought, a fitting place to end my stay there. Not because it was the beginning of the Gulag system, simply, but also because it represents. To many Russians, also some sort of a holy place, because there is on this islands there is a very old monastery with a very interesting history. And these days, if you go to Salavki, you can say it's like a diamond. A diamond has many faces. And just like Russia has many faces, and if you go to Salavki, you can see many of these faces of this country in one place, which made it for me interesting to go there.
There is a small museum. It became a monastery again. It's a small archipelago in the White Sea in upper north, Salavki.
Yes, it's a very beautiful place, but that's the romantic side of it. It's also mostly a very harsh place to live. For most of the year, you can't even get there. These days, of course, you can get by plane, but most of the year, it's simply impossible to reach it. We went there and we found that, yes, there is, of course, the church is back in a big way on this island. The monastery itself is very impressive monument. It also was, of course, a prison and a part of the Gulag system, but it existed hundreds of years before that. And it was very interesting to see there were many pilgrims, Russian pilgrims, who went to the holy place, but there also were many Russian tourists. And there is, since I think 2009, so for the 4 years, there is in one of the former barracks, there is a museum of the Gulag, which is very impressive. Olga Bocharova, who is the historian who deals with the Gulag history on the island in the state museum there, she gave a very impressive, wide-ranging history of the Gulag, which lasted 3 hours. And in our group, there were maybe 20, 25 Russian tourists, and they were simply mesmerized by this history and this speech. And it was really unique, because afterwards I asked her, so do you think in the whole of Russia I can find another place where I would be informed so well about this history? And she's a very modest woman, but she had to answer that, no, I don't think you will. Because before, for instance, I was in Vorkuta, which is really, it's simply one, the whole history is of the Gulag there. But there is one stone which commemorates the victims in the city, and that's about it. You can't find any museum or any other place where this history is commemorated, which is almost unbelievable. But in the end, we did find there was in one of the small towns next to it, there was a school, and there the teachers made in one of the rooms in the school, they made some sort of a museum of the Gulag, very interesting. And they went with their students every year in the environment to look for traces of camps, because there are so many, and many haven't even been found yet. So, but they're doing it as volunteers with school children on a very low level.
That's the regional initiative Roginski was talking about in his lecture, and there are many of them, as far as I know. Brings us back to your very interesting lecture, which had one of the theses. There were many theses in it, but one was, can a state that is based on a criminal system develop into democracy without recognizing its criminal roots and the guilt of the perpetrators? There has been no official condemnation. The Germans were forced after the war, were forced from the outside to come to grips with their past. But as you said, Russia won the war, so there is nobody to force Russia to do the same. How to cope with that?
Тут что может быть, можно ли построить демократию, не поняв, что преступление было преступлением?
Well, can you build a democracy if you don't acknowledge that a crime was a crime?
Тут есть вокруг этого вопроса острая полемика.
There's a very sharp polemic around this question.
Я убежден, и деятельность вот моей организации, мемориала, она основана на мысли, что нет, невозможно, что первично понимание преступления преступлением.
I myself and the organization Memorial that I founded together with others is based on the thought, no, this is not possible.
Власть в эпоху Ельцина вообще не хотела этим заниматься.
The power of Russia in the time of Yeltsin didn't even want to address this question.
Потому что они считали, что главное построить рынок.
So, because they thought that, well, most of all these problems will be solved by the market, the market economy.
Сначала мы должны сделать хороший капитализм.
So first we have to build a good capitalism for ourselves.
А потом автоматически к нам придет и понимание истории, демократия и все.
And then all the rest will follow, understanding of our past and democracy and so on.
Про нынешнюю власть я уже говорил, что у нее как раз, в отличие от ельцинской, есть историческая политика, но прямо противоположная вот моей идее.
And the current authorities, as opposed to Yeltsin, do address this question, but they do it in a very different way, as I told you in my lecture.
Но я уверен, что я прав.
But I am convinced that I am right.
В России борьба за историю и за свободу всегда были связаны.
The fight for history and the fight for freedom in Russia were the same fight and have always been the same fight.
Могу привести много примеров.
I can give you a lot of examples, but
кто это сделает? Ну, конечно, мы сами.
We are going to do this.
Конечно, это, конечно, просто давление к тому, чтобы массовое сознание переделалось, никакое давление здесь быть не может. Это наша внутренняя работа.
The question is not about pressure from the outside, it's our inside conscious. It's on the inside, it's a fight on the inside, and it has to come from us.
Повторяю, это работа одновременно и над движением к свободе, и над движением к исторической правде. Это вещи неразрывные.
So this is all in the striving for freedom and historical understanding and historical truth.
You were talking in your lecture also about the way the Second World War or the great Fatherland War, as it's being treated, named in Russia, has been treated by Putin's regime. This makes Stalin a hero, but in people's memory, he's also a villain and a criminal. So the effect of that is a kind of schizophrenia, mm-hmm, in people's minds. But isn't it dangerous for Putin to use Stalin as a person to found his regime on?
Вы сами напоминали в вашей лекции, ну какая роль играет там на Великая Отечественная война и как этим именно пользуется режим сейчас. Сталин с одной стороны он герой, с другой стороны он преступник. Это, ну, получается какая-то схизофрения, так сказать. Как вы думаете, не опасно ли для государства Путина использовать именно вот этот вопрос Сталина для управления историей?
Они мечутся и не знают, что им выгоднее.
They haven't decided yet what's best for them.
Но мне кажется, что вот Сталин, это же не реальный Сталин, это миф о Сталине, это, во-первых, надо понимать.
You know, the first thing you have to understand that Stalin, the story about Stalin is not about the real Stalin, it's about the myth Stalin.
И с одной стороны, это миф о сильной руке, которая управляет государством.
So the first part is that this is a myth of the strong hand that leads the government.
И в этом смысле этот миф легитимирует нынешнюю власть.
And in a sense, this myth legitimizes the powers today.
А с другой стороны, это миф во многом антипутинский.
And the other side of the myth is anti-Putin.
Подумайте сами, вот в сознании простого человека, что он думает о Сталине и о Путине?
Think for yourselves, the simple man, what does he think about Stalin, what does he think about Putin?
Простой сталинист.
A simple Stalinist.
Он думает, вот Сталин, смотрите, он всю жизнь ходил в одной шинели и в одних сапогах, а Путин каждую там неделю меняет костюмы.
So what does the Stalinist think? He sees Stalin, the man who wears the same jacket, the same boots for years and years on end, and Putin, who has a different costume every day.
При Сталине весь Запад нас боялся.
Under Stalin, the whole West, the whole of the Western world feared us.
А при Путине, кажется, он ему
даже Голландия не боится.
А при Путине даже Голландия нас не боится, да?
And under Putin, even Holland doesn't fear us.
Путин только говорит, что он против Запада. На самом деле он все время старается с ними дружить и обниматься.
Putin says that he doesn't like the West, but at the same time he's trying to befriend them.
Сталин был абсолютно бескорыстный человек. Все знают, что после него не осталось никакого наследства детям.
People know that after Stalin there was nothing to turn over to our children.
Он был бескорыстный.
Selfless. I'm sorry.
А про Путина все шепчутся, никто точно не знает, но все шепчутся, что он очень богатый человек.
Putin, on the other hand, nobody really knows. They all talk about him and say that he's very, very rich.
Сталин свернул голову всем чиновникам ворам. Он всех их расстрелял. Сталин расстрелял всех чиновников, которые воровали.
Сталин was very well. He killed all the people that stole from the state.
А сейчас в России тотальная коррупция и воровство.
And as we see now in Russia, there is only corruption and people are stealing.
Okay, Putin, I got the point.
А Путин никого даже в тюрьму посадить не может.
And he can't even put people in prison.
Он только грозит, а на самом деле ничего не может.
He's threatening, but he can't do anything.
Это так что рост популярности Сталина в каком-то смысле создает вот эту антитезу Путин-Сталин, где Путин – это такой имитация Сталина, но не настоящий Сталин.
So what happens is that the whole myth of Stalin is actually not very helpful to the Putin myth, because Putin is only a weak version of Stalin, trying to imitate him.
И я думаю, что Путину это не нравится.
And I don't think Putin will like this.
I think you're right. Arnaud, Roginsky in his speech already spoke about internet as a kind of free space, free world that is uncontrollable for the authorities. What is your impression? Is it a political tool, or what kind of things, interesting things have you witnessed there?
In relation to the Gulag, or simply in relation to political? Well, no, I don't think it's a political tool. It's an alternative political scene which was created probably by accident, and nobody planned it. But it has changed Russia, and it has given the people who want change in Russia a platform to first of all, to discover that they were not alone in sitting by their kitchen table thinking, having these thoughts, but that there was a huge amount of people who have this desire. So it has created an alternative platform for political debate. Of course, most people use the internet for одноклассники and simple social reasons like most people here do. But it has also broken, let's say, the government monopoly on political debate, which I think is very important. So it's a development which is under nobody's control so far, and it has plays a huge role in Russia's transition, I think so.
And do you think that that young people who are free of fear, because they didn't live through communism, they can bring about changes in Russia? Are they politically interested? What is your impression?
Some are, yes. Others are not. I once spent a nice evening at Baikalsk, which is a town by Baikal Lake, where there happened to be a graduation for high school students. So we decided to make a story on this nice day and to ask all these students what were their plans for the future and what were their prospects. And most of all, they were optimistic. They wanted to work, for instance, for the police or for the military or for the government, or wanted to start their own company or to go to Moscow to become very rich and famous. But they didn't translate their desires in a political way at all. So we may be mistaken to think that this is the problem that occupies most young people in Russia today as well. On the other hand, Ansa Lavki, our guide, told us that it's especially young people who come more and more to these to Salavki and to this excursion and who are very interested. She says that, of course, she notices that in Russia it's already long ago that there was this monopoly on information. It simply doesn't exist anymore. So anybody who is curious and who wants to know the facts can find them or can pursue them. And this is really a big difference with how it used to be in Russia, and it shouldn't be underestimated.
Arseny, Gorbachev was the era of hope and optimism. Yes, if you can say so. Yeltsin was economic chaos and civil war. Putin was law or non-law and order. Do you think that there was a moment in the post-communist history of Russia that could have made a difference? A difference? Was there a different solution? And when was that? Или это просто марксизм?
Марксизм тут ни при чем.
Marxism doesn't have anything to do with it.
Быт определяет сознание.
Это все твои знания о Марксе, я понимаю.
It's your knowledge about Marx.
Okay. Я не знаю. Я, конечно, не имею ответа на этот вопрос.
I don't know. Of course, I don't have the answer to this question.
Мне кажется, что действительно, может быть, если выборы 96 года были бы справедливыми, выборы президента 96-97 года,
Ельцина,
да, Ельцина, да, говорят, что он на самом деле выборы проиграл, и что, так сказать, только как-то фальсификации сделали его выборы правильными, я не знаю. Но если бы действительно, может быть, тогда опять вернулись бы коммунисты, и не было бы вот этого надругательства над правым во вторую половину ельцинского царствования, и не было бы двух чеченских войн, то, наверное, было бы все по-другому. Но я все-таки реально, конечно, не вижу вариантов хороших.
I think that if the...
задним числом, глядя назад.
Well, looking back, I don't think if the elections of 1997 had been fair, if they had gone by in the right way, and if the second term of Yeltsin had not seen two wars in Chechnya, and if there had been any kind of verifiability and transparency, then maybe we could have made different choices at some points. But in hindsight, I cannot name a certain moment.
Which makes it also difficult for the West how to address Putin. I mean, was it a logical consequence of the civil war during Yeltsin? we have this famous Netherlands Russia year at the moment. I think this discussion is part of it. What would you suggest the attitude of countries like Holland towards Putin must be?
Пускай относятся как хотят, это их дело.
Well, they should suit themselves. It's their task, so I can tell them what to do.
Только трусить не надо.
But you don't have to show fear. Don't be a coward.
Они ведут себя ужасно трусливо. Я не имею в виду Голландию, я имею в виду очень много разных стран.
I'm not talking about Holland only. I'm talking about many countries when I say that people are cowardly, behave cowardly toward Putin.
Нужно говорить правду прямо и в лицо.
You need to speak the truth right to his face.
Ну, мы же права человека это не внутреннее дело каждого государства.
Human rights is a question that has to be resolved within each state itself.
Это инструмент и способ говорить правду и повод говорить правду постоянно.
It's a reason to speak the truth and it's a way to speak the truth.
Если прямо и честно говорить, то что-то изменится. Я уверен.
If people would speak openly and freely, then things will change, I think.
Конечно, не надо надеяться, что что-то изменится сразу.
You don't have to hope, and your hope will be futile if you think that everything will change immediately.
И, конечно, как бы сказать, не надо учительствовать.
And you don't have to teach other countries.
Но правду надо говорить прямо.
But you have to speak the truth.
Do you agree with that, Arnoud? What is your opinion? Your opinion about this whole discussion about boycotts and.
Well, I think for the Dutch state, I don't know how hypocritical can you get. So simply for us, Russia is a very important economical partner. Even more economic than it need be, because we stepped forward ourselves to become part of the Gazprom International with our Gasunie and our gas policy. So that's simply Dutch policy, and then it's very good to have a friendship year, why not? Another thing is people who oppose certain aspects of the current policies in Russia. We had a very nice article today in the Volkskrant by Roel van Duin, who says, if you want to protest, if you want to show Putin something that you don't agree with him, use the Winter Olympics in Sochi. Because this is the event for which he has lobbied extremely hard, in which tens and tens of billions are invested of Russian money, which could have been invested to build hospitals and roads and do some other things. So this is an extremely, for the government, extremely important moment. And therefore, for those who oppose the policies of this government, and the best opportunity to protest against it. But I think for the Dutch state, I can only agree, don't be afraid and tell the truth. But also don't be hypocritical, because really Russia is, we have very old relations with Russia. And I think also we live in the same neighborhood, so to speak. 20 years ago, we suggested democracy to Russian people when they exactly at that moment wanted bread. Now they're asking themselves for democracy is much better. So I'm sure they will achieve the changes that they want by themselves.
Я не знаю, кого вы имеете под словом «мы».
What do you mean by the word «we»?
Мы – голландское государство.
We, the Dutch government.
Мы – король.
Are we king?
Или мы – общество.
Or is we the society? So, land, society. Or
государства все равно будут вот то всегда вот вести себя вот так.
Government is always behaving in this figure.
Важно, как ведет себя общество.
It's important how society behaves.
Государству я могу дать только один совет.
The state, I can only advise one thing.
Вы должны быть, государство, вы должны быть честными и прямо говорить, что вы думаете, но так, все-таки, но не рвать отношений, потому что любой диалог лучше разрыва.
Be fair, be open in your discussions, be open in your critics, but at the same time always keep the bond that you have with another country, because that's better than any schism.
А обществу, я могу сказать, вы должны быть абсолютно активны, и мы должны чувствовать вашу поддержку, и мы чувствуем по каким-то вопросам эту поддержку, и она для нас важна. И я надеюсь, что наша позиция важна для нас и для вас тоже.
And to the society, I can tell, please be active, please remain active. We need to feel your support. We need to be able to ask for your support, and we hope that our question is valuable to you, as your questions are to us, so that we are valuable to each other.
Нельзя восхвалять гринписовцев.
Don't only cheer for the Greenpeace people.
Я абсолютно разделяю их цели.
I share their visions.
Но их форма их работы провокационная.
But the way they work is provocational.
Но жестокость, с которой их наказывают, абсолютно недопустимая жестокость. И я решительно против этой жестокости.
But the force with which those actions were sanctioned is way too much. So there's also that.
И мне кажется, что если мы поймем все это одинаково, то само собой ситуация решится в лучшую сторону.
So if we understand this, then and if we keep the bond, then this question will resolve itself.
Well, I want to add to it because I think it's very important to make this distinction between government and government policies and the people. And as I am afraid sometimes this distinction is lost in the Netherlands when the people talk about Russia. And it's, of course, it's a big pity. We could have done more probably in Europe. I'm not saying in the Netherlands, but we could have done more earlier in the sphere of, for instance, simply exchanges and letting, getting young Russians, inviting them here to study here, to get to know us, and sending more people there. Such very simple things, which were done, by the way, after the Second World War between the United States and European countries, and which actually were quite successful, which was some, they have never been really, such ideas never got far with Russia. And to me, that's a disappointment.
Getting back to Greenpeace, why does Russia always criminalize society? Because it's obvious that they trespass the law, and maybe it's obvious that you should be punished for that. But the measures of punishment are, in a way, you could say, is it a Stalinist reflex?
Это правильно. Очень похожая ситуация с Pussy Riot и с Greenpeace.
Yes, this, you're right. The same question goes for Pussy Riot as it goes for Greenpeace.
И с болотным делом в России, когда молодых людей судят за какое-то что-то они якобы плохое сделали во время демонстрации.
And with these cases where young people go to a demonstration and they have done something wrong there.
Совершенно ясно, что это административные нарушения, нарушено административное право.
So it's very clear that this is an I need to think how to translate this into English. A violation of the administration of justice.
А всех их судят как по уголовному праву, как криминальных преступников.
They make it a criminal case, as if they were criminals.
Понятно, что это абсолютное, вот такой полный переворот, и это против реально, против закона и права, то, что с ними делают со всеми.
So what they do here is like a total turnaround of this principle, and that is against the law, in a way.
И на этом мы должны акцентировать наше внимание.
And we should give this our attention, our full attention.
И вы, и мы вместе.
Okay. You and us both.
I'm told that we have to finish, more or less. So the last question, I will go back to history and to Memorial. Is Memorials are the archives that and the letters that people gave to Memorial in good trust, are they safe? and if Memorial is not allowed to accept any foreign money, because otherwise it will be labeled as an Inostrani agent, is the state willing to support Memorial, or is it that a kind of support you would refuse?
Во-первых, мы можем брать иностранные деньги. Никто этого не запрещает.
Well, the first thing I'd like to say is we can take foreign money.
Это не запрещено.
It's not forbidden.
We'll collect in few moments.
Во-вторых, мы не будем регистрироваться как иностранные агенты ни при каких обстоятельствах.
And there will be no circumstances that will lead us to registering ourselves as an иностранный агент, as a foreign agent.
Ну просто потому что мы не иностранные агенты.
Because we are in fact not a foreign agent.
Потому что за вот по этому обвинению в шпионаже в пользу других государств в нашей стране расстреляли сотни тысяч людей.
This is a foreign agency is what they killed people for in our country. This was something used in espionage and the like.
Это было бы ложь. Брать на себя вот это клеймо.
It would be a lie to take this label upon ourselves.
И аморально одновременно.
And it would be amoral.
Что касается безопасности.
And regarding the question of safety and security.
Ну мы живем в России.
We're living in Russia.
Я думаю, что мы будем нормально продолжать свою работу.
I think that we will be able to continue our job normally.
У нас не такие ужасные. Мы абсолютно постоянно критикуем власть по самым разным поводам.
We are constantly criticizing the authorities.
Каждый день.
Every day.
Сейчас мы выставили в список 70 политических заключенных, которые, как мы считаем, есть в России.
And we have made a list of 70, in our opinion, political prisoners that are in Russia right now.
Сегодняшней России.
So the contemporary Russia right now.
Среди них вот все эти ребята гринписовцы.
Among them are the Greenpeace guys who are in prison right now.
И Пусси Райт, и Болотное дело, и другие. И девочки из Пусси Райт.
And the Pussy Riot girls.
И персонажи Болотного дела, и другие. Там список на 70 человек, которые мы анализировали и считали. Но, несмотря на эту всю критику, почему-то я не верю, что государство хочет нас уничтожить. Мне кажется, все гораздо более сложно.
But despite all the criticism we give them, I don't have the feeling that the authorities would like to shut us down. It's more complicated than that.
Я думаю, что мы будем нормально продолжать работать.
So I think we will be able to continue our job.
Я в этом уверен просто.
I truly believe that.
Sounds terrific. It's a good note, to optimistic note to end the conversation. Thank you for your participation and you for your extremely patient behavior.